It's Friday, 9th of June, 2023. St. James's Park, Newcastle. A sold-out crowd. Capacity 52,405 awaits. The time is 8:45 p.m. and Holly Humberstone and Inhaler sit back and relax after astonishing sets. Two great artists in their own right, but they won't compare with what's to come. I always used to joke with the boys that one day we might play St. James's Park in Newcastle, an excitable Sam Fender tweeted back in September. And that time is now. A drop of sweat streaks down the forehead as the roars of 50,000 adoring fans ring out. This is the moment. A childhood dream is about to become reality. But this didn't happen overnight. Far from it. This took years of graft, resolve, and willpower. Afraid anxiety could take over. A final swig of his beer is gulped down in one. The sweat is wiped away, and he begins his walk on. This isn't the boxing. This isn't the darts. But this walkout will be the loudest ever heard by the 29-year-old. Let's make history. This will be the scene in a month's time, and will be the crowning achievement for the young man. But how did we get there?
Hey, what?
I hope you were saying good things about
me. How are you? I was just saying Mike Loon's
Oh my God.
There's nobody here, and we need to do an end of the show show. What are we going to do?
Hold on. Is that Sam Fender?
I think that is.
He's going to the party.
Let's go and find him.
Come on.
And everyone passes, everyone I've seen. I did about 1,000 selfies. Got proper mobbed, and they gave us, but everyone was absolutely fast, and they gave us a lot of cans, and I'm really hungover. I'm really, really hungover.
For many artists, the idea of youthful hardship and working-class life has become a necessity, whether they have lived it or not, with many claiming this as their own, to be seen as representing the masses. Our most high-profile example of this comes in the form of Damon Albarn and Blur, with songs like Park Life and Country House being written through a working-class lens by middle-class writers.
I'm a massive fan of Blur.
Infamously, their battle with Oasis was dubbed the Battle of the Classes, with Oasis representing the council estate Mancunians and all the working class. Meanwhile, Blur were considered middle-class posh boys. Albarn himself did study at art school, but in the same vein, so did Jarvis Cocker. Yet, nobody bats an eye at the Sheffielder singing Common People. I guess he was saved of the middle-class label and accusations by his and Pulp's sheer northernness. Let us ignore the fact that Jarvis's mother was in fact the conservative politician in Sheffield at the time. Oh, yeah. Anyway, before we get too off track, I hope this demonstrates that music and class have held hand in hand for decades, and today is no exception. In today's world, artists attempt to portray this manner through use of accents and behaviour, with Jamie T and Slaves representing both of these facades. As we all know, the music industry is an ever-growing, ever-changing landscape, and now more than ever, it is becoming harder to differentiate the genuine from the fabricated. One artist, however, who has no difficulty in proving his authenticity is Samuel Thomas Fender. Sam Fender. The last 5 years have truly been spectacular for Sam, riding the coattails of a hypersonic missile into the stratosphere, becoming a household name in the meantime, whether it be his raw talent, his TikTok trending song 17 Going Under, or his hungover antics on BBC Breakfast.
I'm really, really hungover.
We are now all aware of the Geordie, but it wasn't always plain sailing for the man. Far from it. Similar to the tale of many others who have grown up in working-class houses, the challenges can mount up, often leaving you feeling helpless. But occasionally, a diamond can be formed from the rough. And today we're going to be discussing a diamond who is shining particularly brightly at this time. Illness, betrayals, and abandonment. But nevertheless, a story of hope, happiness, and self-care. ADHD and a compromised immune system aren't stopping today's star from making it. So, without any further rambling, this is Sam Fender, a portrayal of determination. The 90s were a strange time. Boy bands reigned supreme. Dance music and raves electrified the nation. And rock music was in the charts. Take April 24th, 1994, for example. The charts ranged from Erasure to Take That, the Backstreet Boys to Bruce Springsteen and Red Hot Chili Peppers. With this in mind, our artist of the day was born one day after, on the 25th of April 1994. With these bands being at the forefront of British music at the time, it's clear to see where Sam got his inspiration, with the Geordie Springsteen banner following him around, even if he isn't too keen on it. That said, he is opening for Bruce in Italy, so hey-ho. Regardless of this, we all know that musicians often pay homage to the tunes they were listening to in their youth, and so we must go back to the start to begin our understanding of Geordie Springsteen. As I previously mentioned, Sam was born on the 15th of April 1994 in North Shields, England, 8 miles northeast of Newcastle. North Shields is renowned for its bustling fish quay, dubbing several restaurants and bars and 20 beaches, making it a popular location for people around Tyneside to visit. The people there are proud of the working-class heritage the town has, and although one local stated it is rough around the edges, what town isn't? Growing up in this sort of environment has clearly had a lasting impact on Sam Fender, with arguably his most popular song, 17 Going Under, a depiction of his youth, and a familiar story for many others. Sam's mother Shirley was a caring lady, a nurse most of her life who would work incredibly hard. She worked for 40 years in the profession, but her career was cut short due to an illness known as fibromyalgia. He has an older brother, Liam, and was raised by both his parents in a terraced house in a North Shields suburb. Father Alan and brother Liam are both musicians in their own right. Liam plays drums, and Father Alan is a singer-songwriter, guitar player, and electrician-turned-music teacher. Younger life was bliss for Sam, himself describing his first 10 years as comfortable within the musical family. However, life was about to change for the young man, with hardship about to come. A broken home, losing loved ones to drug abuse and a wretched stepmother, a familiar tale for many, and the story for Sam also. For fans of The Borders, Sam's personal favourite from Hypersonic Missiles, the stories told in the 2019 single refer to a lot of the damage Sam faced as a teenager. At the age of 8, Fender's parents split, and his mother moved up to the Scottish borders. A couple years after this, Fender was kicked out of the house by his father. But all sources suggest he was actually forced out by his stepmother. The Borders is based on this time in Scotland, and although Sam stated the memories are inferred, not directly addressed, they still paint us a very vivid picture. The opening lyric to the song states, but this quickly takes a dark turn. From the lyrics, we can gauge an understanding that Sam's friend, who is discussed in the song, was jealous of Sam's father sticking around when he had a seemingly tough upbringing, turning the boy into a bully. You pinned me to the ground, 8 years old with a replica gun pushing in my skull, saying you're gonna kill me if I tell. Sam emotionally sings in the same verse, with the lyrics seemingly coming from his own experiences. The second verse portrays Sam's own difficulties. I can't stand me too, for me is a very telling line, and would be the first dive into discussing personal mental health in Sam's lyrics. The verse tells us how his friend's godmother supported him. Oh, your godmother repaired the anger in me, didn't take sides, and didn't turn me against my dad. Explaining the positives of this relationship. Only for the next line, then she took those pills, and now she's gone. This described how Sam and his mother discovered the body of his friend's godmother, who had committed suicide. Like anyone, this would have a huge impact, with Sam stating, "Suddenly mortality became real. Life and death became concrete." The song continues with, "I see her in the night in the corner of my eye," which is a clear message of the trauma suffered. Carrying on, The Borders portrays messages of the violence in Fender's past, putting all his past suffering on display through 5 minutes 32 seconds of music. Finally, we learn how Sam's old friend, if we can even call him that at this point, got into bother with his violent tendencies. This ends the tale, as Sam leaves the Borders to move back in with his father. But our story is only getting started. Get it? Getting started? Never mind. The Borders went on to win the Critics' Choice Award at the 2019 Brit Awards, a prestigious award which has also been granted to the likes of Adele, Florence and the Machine, James Bay, and many others. It's crazy to think so much was told within this song. But that's the same with all of Sam's music. They tell us stories and make imagery of the world around us. We are now starting to get a grasp of what childhood was like for Sam in those early years. But what was the environment around him like? Like me, Sam grew up in the early 2000s. And let me tell you, seeing parents made redundant and scrape together the bare bones to survive really does stick with you in many ways. For one, you want to help them. You want to make something out of yourself so you can support them, and you don't want to be in the same situation yourself. Sam himself stated that, "My mum was ill and being pushed to work when she wasn't fit to. I saw what it was like to struggle." Those first 10 years, when the family was together in the terraced house, again speaks volumes to me having lived that same life. And although Sam has gone on to greatness, the 10 years that followed his parents' split were tough. The 2000s were full of financial hardship for millions. Dreams of growing up and getting those big jobs for people like me or Sam are just that. Dreams. Parents who have grown up in areas like this teach you to live the same. To grow up, leave school, get a dead-end job until you die. It's bleak. But some of us prevail. I guess this is where Sam was a tad fortunate, as he grew up in a musical family. And if there is one thing we all know, is that music is the most powerful tool in the world. And for Fender, it was his ticket out. He wasn't athletic, he wasn't into football, he was into music. And the more I look into this, I'm starting to recognize that music wasn't an option for Sam. It was the only option for him. On an appearance on BBC Radio 1 with Scott Mills, Sam shared a letter he wrote to his 10-year-old self, in which he told himself not to feel ashamed for being sensitive and empathetic.
"Hey Sam, I can picture you now, chubby little thing."
Lightsaber in hand, it began. "I wonder how many lampshades you've broken this year. Don't worry about it though. Your dad's a jack of all trades. He can fix anything. Even the car window you're gonna smash in a couple of months' time. Just throw an imaginary grenade next time." You see, at the time, Sam Fender was what you can only describe as a chubby teenager. He wasn't the gleaming Topshop model we know today with carved cheekbones, far from it. And this led to ridicule from classmates in school, with grief a daily occurrence. He continues, "Don't pay attention to any of the kids that give you grief for your hair or your weight. You're gonna lose all of that in 3 years anyways. It's just puppy fat. With any luck, 10 years after this, your former classmates will be begging you to play their weddings, at which time, you can tell them to fuck off." Something Sam takes remarkable pride in. If you want to watch the whole message Sam read to himself, I have linked this in the description of this episode, and trust me, it is a tearjerker. When he turned 13, Sam began his musical journey. Beginning to gig in North Shields was a big step, and this initially started with best mate Dean Thompson, who still plays alongside Sam in his band. Their first gig was Uncle Dean's birthday party, in which they covered the classic noughties indie rock hit Kings of Leon, Sex on Fire. A year on from the covers, Sam began writing and singing his own songs, a masterstroke for the young man, whose talents would begin to shine through. Learning to sing by listening to Jeff Buckley's Grace is not an easy thing to compare yourself to, but I guess to be the best, you must beat the best. Sam's brother Liam held an open mic night in one of the local bars, and Sam would begin participating. He has gigged many a time at his favourite pub, the Low Lights Tavern, which has had many a mention in Sam Fender's songs, and we have a nice little anecdote about the bar later. But for now, Sam is 15. He has formed his own band, and is now going to enter the Teenage Cancer Trust competition. This would be Sam Fender's first interaction with the mainstream, with the 1975's Matty Healy being a judge in the competition. Interestingly, Matty took a keen interest in the Geordies, being wooed by their talent, and Sam's band would go home with first prize. Despite this first step into the limelight, it would still be several more years of busking and gigging before being entirely discovered. And I feel this is a good place to share a little message of my own. One thing that has been clear to me throughout my research on Sam Fender is his complete appreciation of all the opportunities that have been presented to him, and of all his experiences. For those who don't know, a Brit Award now stands in the Low Lights Tavern, and you can visit and get a pint poured through it. This is another show of Sam's complete appreciation and down-to-earth nature, that he still recognises those early days as the most pivotal in his journey. I feel like many upcoming bands nowadays shy away from the local gigs, the difficult empty venues and the drunken hecklers. At the time of writing, Sam was back in the local pub playing at an open mic night this week, playing a new song for the punters, so it just goes to show. But this can also be where you make your break, and Sam Fender is no exception, as his manager-to-be, Owen Davis, happened to discover him during a performance at the local tavern. In music, you can work as hard as possible and not get your break, and for some people it falls into their lap, which is why it is one of the hardest industries to break into. But when you do get your break, it is imperative you take it. When Ben Howard's manager, Owen Davis, saw Sam performing in the Low Lights Tavern back in 2013, he immediately took the 18-year-old on as a client. Throughout 2013 and 2014, Sam would play a series of shows, with support sets with Ben Howard and Willie Mason. It was at this time Sam's ambitions began to grow, with him stating just how desperate he was to write songs he thought would be popular, to get himself and his mother out of their financial and living situation. However, this motivation was possibly misplaced, and like we've seen with many artists before, writing a hit and writing songs for yourself that you believe can often come hand in hand. Try to write a number one song that you don't believe in, you will fail. And it took an extreme life event for Sam to change his outlook on his songwriting. This time also coincided with his mother losing her job nursing, as mentioned previously due to illness. And Sam was at a crossroads. He was in an environment surrounded by drugs, and he suggested becoming a drug dealer to support the family financially, but fortunately, was talked out of it. When he was 20 years old, Sam's father moved away to France, and shortly after, Sam was diagnosed with a potentially life-threatening illness, which forced him to take 2 years out of the industry. We don't have much information on the illness, as Sam has kept this pretty much to himself, although we do know he has a compromised immune system, otherwise known as immunodeficiency. I have seen rumours online from the time, asking if Sam had cancer or something else like it, and immunodeficiency is the state in which the immune system's ability to fight illnesses like cancer is compromised, or completely absent. Like I said, we don't know the ins and outs of Sam's illness, but it is obvious that this would have a lasting effect on the Geordies' physical and mental health. For starters, it has led to further health complications, with him suffering a vocal cord hemorrhage in 2019. But as I previously mentioned, the illness did lead to a change in outlook on Sam's songwriting and storytelling, and I recall reading an article in which he says it was the best thing to ever happen to him. Possibly having his dream snatched away directly led to a hungrier, better version of himself. Thankfully, he recovered, and began to record and release music for the first time. His debut single, released 30th of March 2017, was Play God. Showing complete mastery over his vocals, Play God later went on to be part of the FIFA 19 soundtrack. It doesn't have the trumpets and horns of his later tracks we would come to know and love. It is elegantly simple and lyrically provocative. His immediate success with Play God saw him support the likes of Declan McKenna and Michael Kiwanuka, but it wasn't quite his breakout into the mainstream. Friday Fightin' and Start Again were further releases by Sam in 2017, which led to his first whiff of fame, being placed in BBC's Sound of 2018 shortlist, alongside the likes of Billie Eilish, Khalid, and Lewis Capaldi. Not bad company if you ask me. Later in 2018, he would sign to Polydor Records, release Dead Boys, which was featured as Annie Mac's hottest record in the world, and would then go on to perform this on Jules Holland alongside Leave First. Sam's stock was rising rapidly, and people were starting to get an understanding of the nature of Sam's writing. Dead Boys is the prime example of Sam writing on personal experiences, spilling out his emotions, and this, for me, is the main reason he has reached the level he has. People relate to songs which have meaning. Look at songs like The Drugs Don't Work by The Verve, and Dead Boys is in that category. It was inspired by a friend of Sam's who took his own life. Although this did cause Sam to have some internal conflict, as he didn't want to be seen as capitalizing on the tragedy of a mate, he opened up to his team, and then they opened up back. Sam said that this highlighted that not many people talk about it, that there's still a lot of stigma involved, and then releasing the track was a no-brainer. Sam said in an interview with Radio X that it's definitely done better than it did bad. It did more than good, though, with the song literally changing and saving somebody's life. Quote, there was a guy who was on his way to kill himself, and he was driving his car. He was going to drive his car off the road, and I was on the radio and doing a chat about Dead Boys and singing a song. And the presenter got an email 6 months later, and I got tied into the email as well. And it was basically saying that he heard what was on the radio, and because of that chat on the show, he pulled over, cried his eyes out, went home to his wife, and said he needed help. End quote. Again, I will link the interview in the description below, but I think this opened Sam's eyes to the power of his music and his lyrics, and his writing has gone from strength to strength ever since. 2019 would be an extraordinary year for Sam and the band, with Hypersonic Missiles being released in September of that year, debuting at number one in the British charts. Fender re-released Play God, winning the Critics' Choice Award at the 2019 Brits. He performed the song in his first ever BBC Live Lounge appearance, as well as a cover of Ariana Grande's Break Up With Your Girlfriend, I'm Bored. In March, Hypersonic Missiles, the single, was released, and this was my first brush with the Geordie, an unorthodox love song, which again provides us with lyrics on Sam's surroundings. The opening lines encapsulating this.
Dutch kids have balloons in the parking lot. The gold notches illuminate the business park.
A damning indictment of the drug culture in the UK at the time, with Sam's anti-capitalistic writing coming to the forefront. It's a dense, compelling picture of the modern world, from politics to social change, to the world grinding to a halt thanks to climate change and war. Hypersonic Missiles set the tone for the album, with other songs like White Privilege and We Will Talk blending in his views of politics, the world around him with relationships and the people in his current and past life. A lot happened for Sam in 2019. It was the year he truly blasted into the mainstream, so I'd like to list a few of the achievements from that year. He appeared on The Graham Norton Show alongside Jack Whitehall and Peter Crouch, played Radio 1's Big Weekend, performed on The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon, performed at Lollapalooza, he released a debut number one album, sold out a tour, including 2 nights at the O2 Brixton Academy and 4 nights at the O2 Academy in Newcastle. Later that year, he released All Is On My Side, a fan favourite, but not deemed fit for the album. He was also due to play Glastonbury, but due to his aforementioned vocal cord injury, this was cancelled, alongside several other shows. A further tour was announced and sold out for March of 2020, but due to COVID, this was later postponed. We are now at the dreaded COVID part of all of our lives, and I will skip over most of this. And for the most part, nobody did anything anyway. However, Sam has been particularly vocal about his time during lockdown, admitting he dealt with it horrendously, and it really affected his mental health. Due to his life-threatening illnesses mentioned earlier on, Sam had to shield from people, and therefore was alone for large amounts of time, in which he just drank, overate, and played video games, making him fairly miserable. Not afraid to open up on his mental health, Sam, who lost a friend to suicide, said he got so low he had similar thoughts of ending it. Silly thoughts did come into my head, he said in an interview with The Guardian. This ability to open up and share, for me, is something I respect most about the man from North Shields. A mainstream male star opening up is sure to pave the way for many other people to do the same. But for now, enough of the doom and gloom. So let's get into Sam becoming a household name, with 17 going under. Well, it didn't last long, did it? We are back in the doom and gloom. Sam, mate, if you're listening, release a happy song, man, for God's sake. On the 7th of July 2021, Sam released his now most famous song, the 10th biggest song of 2022. Just last night, I started watching the new Waterloo Road. And what song opens the whole series? You guessed it. The lead single and title track of Sam's second album. And what a song it is. The song brushes around the time in his life he was 17 and struggling to help his mother financially. This takes us back to the time he was also trying to write that hit song. It's crazy to think him writing about his life at the time when he tried to write a hit song itself turned into the biggest song of his life. That change in writing style post-illness changed his life. And I believe 17 Going Under is the biggest indictment of that, as it directly reflects on himself. The lyric... are very powerful, and became an incredibly popular social media sound snippet on TikTok, being used over 200,000 times. 17 Going Under was followed by I, a politically charged single describing the polarity between the left and right wing. Another album with similar themes is on the cards. And with bands like Catfish and The Bottleman writing the same thing didn't do them any good. In Sam Fender's case, it is his strongest asset, and what sets him apart from the rest. Not only is he a working-class lad representing the millions of people out there, he does it with total authenticity and passion. He is the leading driver for guitar music in the charts, and he does it with a smile on his face. Later in 2021, the cancelled tour took place finally, and in October 2021, 17 Going Under would debut at number one, meaning Sam is 2 for 2 on number one albums. Now that is some feat. My personal favourite on the album is Get You Down, or Spit of You, both of which are beautiful in their own regard. There are a lot of things that Sam has done in his life, good and bad, which we haven't gone to in this podcast. We have the drug use, we have the acting, the modelling, the philanthropy. But for now, this is all. I hope you've all enjoyed this episode. If you have, please drop us a like or a rating, as this really does help us. Or, just share it to your mates. You can find us on social media at RockstarsPod. And if you'd like to watch the visual version of this podcast, Rockstars the Podcast is on YouTube now. All of our links can be found in the description of this episode. And feel free to send in your suggestions for the next Rockstar we cover. We've been Rockstars the Podcast, and this has been Sam Fender, a portrayal of determination